Am I too close? Should I pan it? Oh, hi everyone. Welcome to our Good Friday show. You know, these days we're all living in these tiny boxes, whether on our computers, in our homes, or our apartments. But here's an idea that's totally out of the box. Can you believe there was actually a resurrection? I know, it blows my mind. So I thought I'd check in with all of our Huntley hosts and ask them, what's so good about Good Friday?
Well, Good Friday is good news to me because that's when Creator God became flesh and dwelt among us, meaning he became like us, and yet he died that death on the cross so that we could be connected to the Father now and forever.
Good Friday is a day that celebrates the extraordinary love that God has for humanity. When you think about a father saving the life of a child or a firefighter laying down his life to save people in a fire, that's what God did for us. And today is the day we celebrate the lengths that he would go for humanity to have relationship with him because of his extraordinary love.
You know, we're all feeling a little bit restricted in what we can do these days and places we can go, but we do have the freedom to tell people about God's love. That is not the case for many followers of Jesus around the world. They are suffering because they love Jesus. Will you take some time and pray for the persecuted church as they tell people that Jesus loves them?
Hey, Jakey.
Yeah?
What's so good about Good Friday in your opinion?
I think Good Friday is a good day because when God sent out Jesus to sacrifice his life on the cross, so we could have a connection to him. God could be anywhere in the world with every single person.
God's love is really boundaryless.
Indeed it is.
Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
That's what Good Friday means to me.
Welcome to 100 Huntley Street. We are so glad that you have joined us on this Good Friday. And this is the first time in the history of 100 Huntley Street that we have ever done the entire show on location from our homes. Obviously, this is because of COVID-19 and the global pandemic, but we have a fantastic show for you today.
And we're going to do something unique we haven't done before. We're going to have communion online. So get the juice, get the bread. That's coming up a little bit later.
Yeah, we really do hope you join us. I'll also be speaking via video conferencing with Dr. Craig Evans. He is a scholar and a teacher, and we're going to be talking about the archaeological and the historical evidence for the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. Something people are always talking about this time of year. You're going to find this fascinating.
And we also, of course, have to have music, and we have award-winning modern hymn writers, Keith and Kristen Getty, music later. But right now, Mark sits down with the Gettys.
Well, in an age that's obsessed with progressive worship music, my guests occupy a lane that recognizes them as leaders in the art of modern hymn writing. Probably best known for their hymn, In Christ Alone, which I might add is sung in churches between 40 and 50 million times a year, Keith and Kristen Getty embrace their calling and wholeheartedly serve the church. When they're not touring the world or running their annual Sing Music Conference, they split their home time between Northern Ireland and Nashville, Tennessee with their four daughters. Welcome, Keith and Kristen. How are you doing today?
Fantastic.
I'm dandy.
enjoying being quarantined in Nashville.
How are the spirits of Nashvillians these days?
Well, the city has been very pressed down, and we know a lot in terms of the media outlets that we would follow to find information, and then our friends. One of the things that has excited me so much is the mobilizing of local churches here. Our own, which we can speak into, has just done phenomenal work through transferring so much of their community assistance online, from their services to their Bible studies to their youth groups, and really being intentional about reaching out to people while they're so isolated. And that has just really excited me and made me just very, very proud of our church and what they're doing, and excited to be part of what they're doing. This past Sunday, we sat outside with our girls and sighing our hearts out following our church service, and I know that many other families are doing the same. And you know, we continue to pray with our girls daily for medical professionals who live around us. Their work is just, it is just awesome what they have to do, and it's a huge task and of incredible sacrifice. So we're praying for them daily as a family, and like in every state, every country, constantly praying for the wisdom of our leaders as they navigate things which they never have had to before.
So we're seeing this as such an amazing time for the body of Christ and the church to kind of stand up step up to the plate and really meet a need. I want to ask you about a project that you're working on right now. You're kind of two volumes into a five volume series called Quintology. Now you've finished it. Incarnation has already been recorded and released. Passion has been recorded and released, which is kind of interesting because we are now Good Friday today, coming to the end of Passion Week. Right. And you've got three other installments in this Quintology. What are the names of them? And what have you found has been especially impactful, where sort of thematically grouping songs and writing songs for a project based on certain themes in our Christian faith?
Sure. They were all recorded at the Sing conference last year. As many of you know, we invite everyone to come to Nashville for this massive hymn singing experience every summer. And we invite, God willing, we'll have about 15, 16,000 people between all the events this year doing that. But last year it was the theme of the life of Christ. So rather than just make a live worship album, we thought, why not actually go through that? We're just ahead of the church's year. We actually echo the church's year and actually group it into five loves. So Incarnation came out in November as people were getting ready for Christmas. Passion came out during the season of Lent. And then the resurrection stuff is now coming out as well. So I think we'll be for Easter. Then we move in April, May to the Great Commission as people are planning for summer outreach. And then we finish with Heaven and Eternity as the last one. So that's kind of, that was the idea of the whole thing.
So, okay, so today we're Good Friday. And I want to ask you, either one of you, it doesn't matter, to give us a bit of a reflection on the cross.
On a personal level and with the greater solitude that we have, that has sort of been forced upon us, but with our family, I'm very excited in the next, over this Easter weekend, to dwell on some of the key hymns that we've been teaching to our children and to linger more on trying to explain to them what it means and using the hymns to tell those stories. You know, they have been learning them for several years and I want to sort of gather them together and really start to fill in more of the blanks with them, because our eldest is a firm believer. She's 9 years old. The next one is 6 and then 4, and they're just at the age where they're really starting to understand in deeper ways, and I don't want to miss this opportunity. You know, what am I called to do is to raise my kids and to advance the gospel in the lives of these little children that God has given me, and having taught them the songs, I want to talk to them about them, get them singing them and remembering and understanding who the Lord is and what he's done. I feel such a strong sense that I want these two middle daughters particularly to come to a saving faith in the Lord Jesus. And that's one of the biggest pushes, I think, for our life.
And I think that's important for us to remember, Kristen, is that this time, it's a season that God has given to us to be very intentional about investing in those relationships that are most important to us. But I want to thank you for joining us. And we're going to hear some music from you later on in the broadcast. So we want to make sure that people stay tuned. We're going to probably take us off the air with a song. But thank you, Keith and Kristen, and for all of your family. Thank you for just sharing with us. And we just pray God's blessing on you and God's richest blessing on you this Easter season. And we look forward to having you in our studios in Burlington when we can fly again.
Yeah, I can't wait for that to happen.
It'll be great again. Great to be back. There's so many happy memories of being with you guys. So
we love that. Well, thank you so much. God bless you. And we'll check in with you in coming weeks to see how things are going.
Yes. All right, man. Thank you.
Well, it is that time of year when conspiracy theorists and skeptics alike examine the claims of the Bible surrounding the life and death of Jesus. Joining me to dive into the historical proof of these events is one of the foremost scholars alive today in New Testament studies, Dr. Craig Evans. Thanks so much for joining me.
My pleasure.
So let's just start with the obvious question. Did Jesus Christ actually exist?
Of course he did. And the evidence for his existence in the time in which we believe it took place, the first three decades of the first century, the evidence is simply overwhelming.
And can you break down just a little bit of that? And what way is it overwhelming?
It's overwhelming in several ways. One of them is that we have sources that describe his life within the very generation of his eyewitnesses, the people who knew him, his disciples and family members. But what sometimes gets overlooked when people debate the Gospels, when they were written, and were they based on eyewitness testimony, and how much, what gets overlooked is the testimony of the Apostle Paul himself. He wrote several letters. Most of them are not disputed by anyone. They're recognized as authentic that Paul wrote them. And among those letters, two are very important, 1 Corinthians and Galatians, two letters that Paul wrote. And in those letters, he talks about the members of Jesus' family, including his relationship to Jesus' brother James. And Paul didn't always see eye to eye with James. So it doesn't sound like a whitewash. It doesn't sound like apologetic. It's a little bit of tension between Paul and James. It's not the kind of stuff people would want to make up. And that's why real scholars, historians around the world, whether they're Christians or not, Jewish or pagan or whatever, they say Jesus existed and Paul knew his family members and sometimes even debated with them the implications of Jesus's teaching, especially with respect to what kind of food one could eat, you know, with Gentiles and so forth. And that's why it's overwhelming. Now, there's more evidence, and that relates to archaeology also. So the picture just keeps building. There is no question that Jesus of Nazareth was a real person, and he did and said the things that the Gospels tell us he did.
Okay, so Jesus existed. We can accept that from a historical, archaeological point of view. But the real crux of everything and all of Christianity centers around his death and resurrection. So tell me about that. What kind of evidence is there to say that that actually happened?
Well, there's plenty of evidence for it. Again, a lot of it is contextual, and it receives support from other sources. Josephus, a Jewish historian, talks about it. What he's trying to do is explain to his Roman readers, Josephus, for some might not know, he survived the Great War from 66 to 70. He became a Roman citizen. He moved to Italy, and he was on very good terms with the new Roman emperor, Vespasian. And so Josephus wrote an account and several books, in fact, and he talks about Jesus, not because he himself was interested in Jesus. He was trying to explain to the Romans who these Christians are and where they get their name. Why are they called Christianoi? What does that mean? And he says, well, it's because their founder was called Christ. That's where it comes from. But for me, what really impresses me is that the Gospels describe things sometimes incidentally. And archaeology in the last 50 years shows that what the Gospels are talking about is real. That's the way it actually was. And you can now go there and dig it up. And that includes, above all, the whole idea of burial and resurrection, the empty tomb, what the Gospels say about Jesus' burial, all of that. And by the way, I know Jewish archaeologists, and you might say they have no theological dog in the fight, and they say, yeah, the Gospels have it right. What they say is in step with everything we know, including archaeology. So the Gospels, I think, hit the nail right on the head in their description of Jesus' death, burial, and the discovery of the empty tomb.
Well, it is such a pleasure to talk to you. I know that you've said in the past, archaeologists use the Bible as a reference tool because of this very thing. It's amazing, and I know it's completely unfolding all the time. So we love checking in with you. Happy Easter. Thank you so much for joining us, Dr. Craig Evans.
Thank you, Cheryl.
Last year, I traveled to the Holy Land on scholarship with ICEJ. What an incredible experience. We explored the stunning red canyons, traveled through Hezekiah's tunnel, and I even rode a camel. While driving through the Judean hillside, I saw shepherds tending to their flocks. Our tour guide said this is the same ancient lands where David wrote Psalm 23, "The Lord is my shepherd." But the hillside wasn't lush and green like I expected. It was the exact opposite. And when David wrote this psalm, he knew God would provide even in the desert. I was awestruck by the ancient lands and the people who hold such a deep reverence for God. And in that moment, I felt God whisper to my heart, "Crystal, there are ancient lands in Canada among the Indigenous people." I was thrilled to return to Canada and head out on my next trip. The stories of those connecting to Creator God never cease to amaze me. Darlene Patty from Ministiquin Lake shares briefly what life was like before God ignited hope inside of her.
I work as a prevention worker. One of my focus is, you know, to have a desire to really help the young people there because they're going through some challenges. I was at that place where I was depressed and I didn't know about life, you know, how to help myself because I was at that place where, you know, wanted to give up. Sometimes we don't know how to help people when, you know, it comes to that place, but not to blame ourselves. But when I heard that name, you know, Jesus, somebody loved me, that's when I started to live because there was like a light lit up in me. You know, I just want to show love to the young people because they need it, you know, children and the parents. They have a warrior spirit from God and from our Creator. So each one of us do have one, but, you know, we need to build on that and help each other as a team.
I just love what Darlene said. You know, it was like the light lit up inside her when she encountered Jesus in a real way and made a decision to follow him. And now it's affecting her community, especially as she's working amongst the youth, telling them about God's love. And you're watching and going, "I've never encountered Jesus like that." We would love to hear from you today, especially as we remember 2,000 years ago when Jesus died on the cross to give us life now and forever. Our prayer lines are open. We'd love to hear from you. 1-866-273-4444, or you can email us at prayer@crossroads.ca. Here's Laura now with her guest.
During global uncertainty, the church plays a vital role in strengthening people and encouraging resilience in them as they find connection and faith with God. In the COVID-19 pandemic, there's social distancing, and we know we have to redefine our church services. This would include the sacraments and spiritual care. We have Father Simon Lobo, pastor of St. Benedict Parish, with us today, speaking to us from Halifax, Nova Scotia. Thank you for being with us, Father Simon.
You're most welcome, Laura. It's great to be with you.
It's so nice to see you. So in the face of COVID-19, how is that affecting your church services? For instance, Mass or even your Easter services coming up?
Well, as in many places, we're limited. Here in Nova Scotia, we're limited to 5 people in one place. So we're not able to have the churches open for people to come to worship God in our physical building. So we've switch to live stream. We have been live streaming the Mass online, both to livestream.com/St. Benedict Parish or to Facebook Live. And in those places, people have been following along really since 2014, but this is a new reality in that that's the only way people can experience church right now is online. So both our archdiocese here in Halifax, Yarmouth is live streaming the Holy Triduum, Holy Thursday, Good Friday, and the Easter Vigil on Saturday night. And then we're going to be here on Sunday morning at 9 a.m. Atlantic with our Easter Sunday Mass.
Oh, that's amazing. That's so encouraging for people to be able to tune in and still experience the church service. And, you know, in times of crisis, Christians throughout history have been known to take a different approach. And a big part of it is their faith in Jesus and following his example. How can Christians today, those who are followers of Jesus, meet this epidemic and this crisis that we're facing?
Well, the first thing I would say is because, especially as we're coming into the great mystery and celebration of Easter, to have hope, Jesus Christ, who died, rose from the dead. And so I promised myself a few years ago, I had the chance to visit the Holy Land and visit the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, the empty tomb. And I told myself, because Jesus conquered death itself, I will never lose hope. And so this is a moment to not lose hope, but to cling to our faith in Jesus. And secondly, I offered the people in our church a few practical things, 3 P's: pray, protect, pursue. So very quickly, to pray, to believe in the confidence that prayer makes a difference, and to be praying for all those who are sick, those who are dying, those medical workers, those on the front lines, our leaders. It's so easy to criticize them, but we should be praying for them to make wise decisions. Secondly, to protect. And instead of thinking about self-protecting first to go outwards and think, how can I protect other people, especially those who are most vulnerable at this time? And finally, pursue. Look for these ways to keep reaching out. Fear can turn us inwards, but as Christians, I think we need to be going outwards ever more, whether it's picking up the phone or getting on a video call, in some way to pursue others with love.
Oh, thank you, Father Simon. Those were such encouraging words, and we're so grateful to have had you here today.
Thank you so much.
These interesting times necessitate the need for us to come together differently and remember this Good Friday. Right now, our pastor and Bible teacher, Robbie Simons, is going to lead us in a time of communion virtually.
It is wonderful to be together and very, very special on Good Friday. We remember the most important act that this world has ever seen. It is the death of the Son of God, that he died for the sins of you and me. And we got to remember again that without Good Friday, there is no Easter Sunday. I was particularly so blessed to remember the three words that Jesus said on the cross. He said, "It is finished." The moment he said that, the understanding that payment for sin was made, the Lamb of God was slain, and the pathway to God has been opened. Again, how beautiful it is that we can be together in this way to remember and to celebrate the death that has ultimately given us life. We hope you are so thankful on this very special Good Friday. Cheryl, I'd love to hear your thoughts on what Good Friday means to you.
Yeah, you know what? It for me, it is a very serious time to put my heart before the Lord and say, who do I need to forgive? What do I need to repent of? And just receive his cleansing and that fresh start. It's so meaningful. What about you, Lara?
Good Friday really represents for me the time that God took to come into this world and reach out to us. And in the life of Jesus, we find our needs met, we find our suffering ended, we find evil overcome and renewal and a new reality full of God's hope. Crystal, what about you?
Well, for me, I just find that, you know, it's connection with a real God who has tangible love, real love that you can connect to in time of suffering, in time of joy, in time of pain, whatever you may be going through. But he's real and he's available to anyone. That's how much he loves humanity.
And Robbie, we're going to take the elements now.
We are. And again, how beautiful this is and this way and this time. And of course, the remembrance of the Lord's Supper is stated in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, where Paul says this. He says, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, when he had given thanks, he broke it and he said, 'This is my body, which is for you.' And then listen to this, 'Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.'" So us together, how special it is. We get to celebrate the symbols of the body and the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. So team, so thankful to be with you right now. So let's remember the body of Christ given for us. And the blood of Jesus shed for us. Amen.
Father, we thank you that we have been forgiven of our sins. That's an incredible thing. And we are free from the bondages that have held us back. And we have the incredible opportunity to come every time into your presence with boldness, with joy, because of what you have done. And Lord, we know that for now that we walk in forgiveness, and we know that we will spend eternity with you because Jesus died for us and then rose 3 days later so that we would have eternal life. As Robbie said, Lord, we do this in remembrance of you, and we are so grateful. We are so thankful that you have done this for us. We love you. We praise you. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
My worth is not in what I own, not in the strength of flesh and bone, but in the costly wounds of love at the cross. My worth is not
Have you guys subscribed to our YouTube channel yet?
Mm-hmm.
I did. I went to 100 Huntley YouTube channel, clicked on that little red subscribe button. Well, we have a ton of great content on there.
Exactly, like my grandpa David Maines' interview with Reverend Billy Graham.
If Canada should have a spiritual awakening and a spiritual revival, I think it could lead the world.
That was amazing. And did you also know that Justin Bieber was here too?
No way.
You knew that?
I knew that.
And I don't mean to brag, but I was in his movie. This is the clip that played on it.
Justin, you were in the studio. Come on over here. He's a good-looking 14-year-old young man. Have a seat right next to your mom.
Danny?
We've had some amazing moments on 100 Huntley Street.
That's true.
Wow. Bible teaching, moving testimonies, and the music has been incredible. Take a look at this.
Oh, Jesus, yours is a mystery.
All on demand on your favorite device.
Go to our 100 Huntley YouTube channel, click that subscribe button, and tell your friends and family to subscribe too. And hey, remember to click the notification bell so you never miss a life-changing moment.